So in the last video, we took a look at the dehydration of an alcohol to form an alkene, and we looked at the mechanism of how to do so. So in this video, we're going to look at the regioselectivity and the stereoselectivity of this reaction. So first we'll deal with the regioselectivity. So let's go ahead and write that down here. So regio. And it makes it sound like what region of the molecule will this reaction take place, right? So regioselectivity. What region of the molecule will this reaction take place? So we know that the double bond is going to form between our alpha and our beta carbons, but what if we have different beta carbons? And that's where regioselectivity comes in. So let's take a look at a reaction. So let's get some space here. Let's take a look at this reaction, and we'll put an OH on a ring. I'll put it right here. And this time, though, we're going to put a methyl group right here. So when we're trying to figure out the products of this dehydration reaction, right, so if we're reacting this molecule with sulfuric acid and heating it up, where will the double bond form? So let's go ahead and identify our alpha and our beta positions. So we know this is our alpha carbon, and we know that the two carbons next to the alpha are the beta. So that's a beta carbon, and this is a beta carbon. And we know that there are hydrogens on those beta carbons. So let's go ahead and put in those hydrogens here. So we'll put in a hydrogen. We know there's only one hydrogen on this top beta carbon, and we know there are two hydrogens down here. So these are the hydrogens that could take part in our mechanism, which we studied in the last video. So let's call the top one beta 1. So that's beta 1, and our bottom carbon is beta 2. So we'll draw two different reactions here. So if we react this with sulfuric acid and heat, and we think about the product that would form using the hydrogen from the beta 1 position, so I'll make this the beta 1 position, I know that the double bond forms between my alpha and my beta carbons, so I can go ahead and draw the product. I can go ahead and draw this product, and my methyl group is right here. I know the OH is going to leave in the mechanism, and I'm going to form a double bond between my alpha and my beta carbon. So that's one possible product, one possible region where the reaction takes place. Let's look at what would happen if the reaction proceeded via the beta 2 carbon. So the beta 2 carbon, I'm going to form the double bond between the alpha and the beta. So let's go ahead and draw the product. Right, so let's draw the product this time. So here is my methyl group. The OH is going to go away when it leaves this water, and my double bond is going to form between my alpha and my beta carbon like that. So here I have two different products for this reaction. And the question is, which one of these two will be the major product? So this reaction is regioselective. Let's take a look at the degrees of substitution for our product. So if I look at this top example, and I look at the two carbons, right, the two carbons of my double bond, and I think about how substituted is that molecule. Well, there are three things attached to that double bond, and then this is a hydrogen right here. So that makes it a little bit more obvious that this is a tri-substituted alkene, right? This is tri-substituted alkene. And if I look at this alkene product down here, and I look at the double bond, right, so these are my two carbons on my double bond, well, there's a hydrogen here, and then there's a hydrogen here. So this alkene is actually only disubstituted. So I have a trisubstituted alkene versus a disubstituted alkene. And in one of our earlier videos, we talked about the fact that a trisubstituted alkene is the more stable one. So this is the more stable product. Since it's more stable, it makes sense that a higher percentage of your product will be the trisubstituted. So it's about 85%. So if you go ahead and put about 85% of your product is going to be your trisubstituted alkene, and only approximately 15% is going to be your disubstituted alkene. So this reaction is regioselective. Your more stable alkene, your more stable product is called your Zaitsev product, or Zaitsev. So I'll go ahead and write that. So here we have, this is our Zaitsev product. Okay, so this is the one that's going to form most of the time. All right, let's do another example where we're trying to predict the major product using regioselectivity. So let's start again with our alcohol. So let's go ahead and draw an alcohol here. And Same reaction, right? Dehydration of alcohols to form alkene. So we're going to react it with sulfuric acid and heat it up. And once again, your steps are to determine your alpha carbon. This is my alpha carbon, the one that's bonded to my OH. And then how many beta carbons do I have in this example? Well, this is a beta carbon right here, so I'll make that beta 1. This is a beta carbon, so I'll make that beta 2. This is a beta carbon, so I'll make that beta 3. So let's do all three possibilities and take a look and see what we have for our products. So beta 1, I know the double bond is going to form between my alpha and my beta carbon. So let's go ahead and draw the alkene that we would predict. All right, so my double bond is going to form between my alpha and my beta carbon. So my double bond is going to form there when the OH leaves as water. So that's one possible product. Let's go ahead and draw what would happen using the B2, using a proton off of the B2 carbon, so the B2 way. Once again, the double bond is going to form between the alpha and the beta carbon. So if I go ahead and draw my carbon skeleton here, that's my carbon skeleton. The double bond forms between my alpha and my beta carbon. So this time it's right here. So my double bond is right there. And if I compare the product from B2 to the product from B1, they're actually the same molecule. These guys are the exact same molecule. And one way to test for that is go ahead and name them both. Right? If you were to name it, right, let's go ahead and number it. This would be carbon 1, so your longest chain including your double bond, carbon 2, 3, and 4. So it would be butene, right? And your double bond's at 1, so you could say 1 butene if you're doing a full name here, and then your methyl group is coming off of carbon 2, so you could say 2-methyl-1-butene, or just 2-methyl-butene if you wanted to leave the one out, so 2-methyl-1-butene or 2-methyl-butene. And if you go ahead and name the molecule up here, right, this would be carbon 1, this would be carbon 2, this would be carbon 3, this would be carbon 4, hopefully it's obvious that is also 2-methyl-1-butene there. So whenever you're unsure, go ahead and name it, and that'll be the way to figure out that these two are the exact same molecule. So that's really only one possible product we've gotten so far. So now let's look at the B3 possibility. So if we go ahead and draw the product that would result if one of the B3 hydrogens participates in the reaction. So again, our carbon skeleton is going to look like this. And this time our double bond is going to form between the alpha carbon and the B3 carbon. So it's going to form over in here like that. So this is a possible product. So we only have only two products for this reaction, and let's see if we can figure out which one of these two is going to be the most stable. Well, if I go up to this product, 2-methyl-1-butene, I want to classify this double bond. Is it monosubstituted, disubstituted, trisubstituted, or tetrasubstituted? Well, if I put in my hydrogens, it makes it easier to see that it's only disubstituted. So this is a disubstituted product, 2-methyl-1-butene. If I look down here at this double bond, I can see that there are three things attached across the double bond, and then this is a hydrogen right here like that. So this example is actually trisubstituted. And we know that the more substituted product is the more stable one. So approximately 90% is going to be your trisubstituted, and only approximately 10% is going to be your disubstituted. So let's do one more thing. Let's talk about stereoselectivity real fast. So we just did regioselectivity. What region of the molecule takes part in the reaction? Let's do stereoselectivity. So what stereoisomer is formed? So stereoselectivity. So what stereoisomer is formed? So let's look at this reaction. So this alcohol right here, again, a dehydration reaction. Identify our alpha carbon, which is right here. And then two possibilities for my beta carbons. But since the molecule is symmetrical, either beta carbon is fine. It just makes our lives a little bit easier for the products here. So what are the possible products that I could draw for this reaction? Well, let's see. My double bond is going to form between my alpha and my beta carbon. So if I just draw my carbon skeleton here, and I can put a double bond between my alpha and my beta carbon, that's one possible product. So what stereoisomer is that? That, of course, is the trans stereoisomer. So we saw in a previous video how to think about, you know, your two hydrogens being on opposite sides of your double bond here. All right, so my hydrogen here and my hydrogen here on opposite sides. So that's my trans stereoisomer. And My other possible stereoisomer would be the cis version. So I would have to turn that from trans into cis for my other product. So for my other product, I would have my double bond, and it would actually be cis at that double bond. All right? So for this example, your two hydrogens, your two identical groups, are on the same side. So this is another possibility. So two possible products, the trans and the cis. Which one of these is going to be the major product? We talked in an earlier video how trans is more stable than cis due to decreased steric hindrance. So approximately 75% of your product for this reaction is going to be trans, and approximately 25% of your product is going to be cis.